Hello. I'm so glad you've come back. I thought you would want to find out what's happened to our magical fairy. Shall we delve in and find out? She was left in quite a kerfuffle last time. Spring had sprung in the fair valley of Piltonia almost overnight. The flowers were showing off their very best colours, the birds were singing in their best singing voices, and the gardens of the fair valley were alive with the colours and sounds of spring. Queen Lilybell the Red's garden was of no exception. Her head gardener, Prunus Sylvestris, was busy ensuring the royal gardens were well fed and watered so that all who saw the fruits of his labour were amazed at the garden's beauty. And of course he was an exceptional gardener, so it was exceptionally beautiful. Quite astounding. Now, he had managed to grow orchids from the opulent opals, which are extremely rare. I know! Orchids. Which attracted bees away from the apple orchards. Quite marvellous. Thimble had often played in the royal gardens as a little fairy, watching Prunus on many occasions turn a mud patch into a sea of colour. And it was those happy memories which had led her to the great iron gates today. She had wanted to be somewhere inspiring, as sometimes you could hear the Queen herself shouting at an unfortunate servant. Oh dear. Queen Lilybell the Red had grown less tolerant in her older years, and Thimble would have to judge very carefully when to approach her. She wished her father could have helped. She leant back on the heavy metal gates behind her and let out a big sigh. Just then, a loud voice behind her startled her. Well, I do declare, for all the marigolds in this here garden, it's Thimble. To what in the geraniums brings you here, little flower? It was Prunus, who had been weeding at the bottom of the garden when he noticed a tiny figure resting against the gates near his freshly sown raspberry crops. I thought you were probably one of the young knaves after my fruit again, but now I see, with daisies and agapanthus, it's you, little fairy. To what do we owe the rosebud honour? Said Prunus, with genuine delight at seeing Thimble. Well, said Thimble with a little sniff. Oh dear! Thimble burst into tears. Prunus hurriedly gathered together his tools. Oh dear, oh dear, oh daffodil! He exclaimed. Let us sit in the herb garden by the St. John's wort, and you can tell me all your water lily woes. With that, he unlocked the gate and led Thimble into the garden. The old gardener led the way through a gap in the hedgerow and they emerged on the other side next to basil leaves and the brightly coloured flowers of the St. John's wort. Thimble sniffed a little and could still feel tears rolling down her face. She was not at all used to tears and hadn't quite anticipated having them in front of anyone and now felt quite silly. I mean, fairies, by their very nature, are not prone to tears. I know, very sad. Now, little petal, said Prunus, in all the sunflowers in this here garden, I don't think I have ever seen one drop of water fall from your eyes. And that's a lot of sunflowers, said a concerned Prunus, taking out a handkerchief from his top pocket and handing it to Thimble. Prunus had known the Flute family all his life and had been a good friend to Lord Flute when he had spent time writing his speeches in the garden back in the days when he was required to formally address the Royal Council. Every other half moon, I believe. Thimble would sometimes come with him and play in the grand lawns and amuse Prunus with her curiosity of wanting to know the names of all the flowers and all the blooms. Pruna spent many hours telling Thimble the names of all the flowers that grew there. Goodness. And she'd never forgotten his kindness.
Oh, Prunus!
Exclaimed Thimble.
Firstly, you must think I'm a bit silly for crying. And secondly, after hearing what I'm crying about, you may think me very ungrateful and foolish, said Thimble, composing herself and drying her eyes.
Prunus said nothing for a while. He just sat listening. He could see how relieved Thimble was to share her unhappy burden.
You see, for all the herbs in this herb garden, I do not want to get married. And I most certainly do not want to get married to Till if I did, which I don't, said Thimble. And by all accounts, Prunus, I don't know what to do to stop this awful event from taking place, said Thimble, hardly taking breath.
Prunus looked thoughtful. And when Thimble had finished, he stood up and took a peep over the hedge to make sure nobody had been listening.
Have you spoken to anyone else about this, Thimble?
He said, lowering his voice.
Only Father, who said I need to speak to the Queen herself and ask her to reconsider her decision, said Thimble, also lowering her voice,
just as the sound of the Queen shouting at one of her knaves made them both look up with a start. Thimble let out a big sigh.
And I can only imagine how difficult that's going to be, said Thimble in a whisper.
Prunus was silent again for a while. He knew the Queen was no pushover, but had worked in the royal gardens for many, many moons. 9,865 to be precise. And he was more than aware of the Queen's strengths and weaknesses alike.
Well, little petal, he said, we'd best think of something to put Her Majesty in a good mood then.
And he stood up and snipped a couple of unruly leaves from the herbs behind them. Follow me, little flower. We need to go to the royal kitchens to speak to Myrtle Milkwort. She's bound to have just the thing we need. And an excited Prunus disappeared through the hedge and headed up the hill towards the castle.
We'd best make haste. She'll be finishing her breakfast chores soon enough.
Thimble jumped to her feet and followed, although she didn't really much feel like food at the moment, but not wanting to seem ungrateful. And happy for Prunus's kindness, she caught up with him and they headed up towards the royal kitchens. The smell as they approached the big brass door of the kitchens hit them like a velvet blanket of toasted tea cakes and cupcakes. It was quite enough to make their mouths water. The smell of the garden faded from sweet honeysuckle to sweet toffee. Myrtle was busy in front of a huge pot as they quietly entered into the kitchen. She was mixing and tasting, shaking her head and adding ingredients, stirring and folding before lifting her head and looking straight at Prunus with a huge grin, exclaimed,
absolutely bubbly butter perfect.
Myrtle had been the royal cook in the palace for as long as the bricks had been there and was always happy to welcome guests. She took out two plates and two cups before filling them with warm tea from a big pot behind the stove and placed a tea cake on each plate.
So, what brings you lovelies to my beautiful kitchen today then? Honey biscuits or tea?
Thimble wasn't actually sure why they were there at all, and she just smiled politely.
Prunus picked up his tea. Well, Myrtle, I think this little flower might need our help in buttering up the Queen, and I have just the rosebud idea.
Myrtle laughed out loud and sat down on a big stool next to them.
She knew more than anyone how difficult Lilybell the Red could be, and buttering her up had become quite an art form for her.
Now, why would you want to be buttering up the Queen then, little fairy?
Aren't you Thimble, the one I've just been designing a mighty, and even though I do say so myself, a magnificent wedding cake for. Thimble nodded and was just about to tell Myrtle all her troubles when Pruna stepped in. She is one and the same, but as blue as a bluebell about it. And she wants to ask Her Majesty to reconsider the whole idea of marriage to Till. I mean, Myrtle. Even you can see why she wouldn't want to marry Tillarno Twill. Of all the knaves, he's as prickly as a thistle. And indeed, Myrtle could see, and was certainly more than aware of Till's bad behaviour. She would often catch him emptying out her biscuit tins and eating cakes before she'd had a chance to decorate them. And this particularly annoyed her more than anything, and she'd taken to locking her cupboards at night to stop his sticky fingers taking all the breakfast scones. So after a small ponder, Myrtle decided that she was more than happy to help with whatever Thimble may need of her. Thimble tasted her tea. "Goodness!" she exclaimed. "This is the best tea I have ever tasted." Myrtle shrieked with delight and clapped her hands. "Well, I am pleased you like it, Thimble. I think you and I are going to get on like a toasted tea cake. But we must get on with business. As I know the Queen can be very stubborn once a bee has flown in her bonnet, we'll have to come up with something extremely tasty. And I have the very thing." Thimble looked hopeful for the first time since the whole marriage thing to Till had been announced. "You do?" she inquired eagerly. "I do indeed," said Myrtle, adjusting her cook's hat. "And we shall start this very morning." "Oh no, those are the calling birds. I shall have to go, they seem to come round quite soon. Yes, all right, I'm hurrying. I'm going to have to go. I know you shall want to come back next time and find out what on earth they're going to cook up. Till then, take care. And remember, don't stop believing, especially in you."